You're listening to This Week in America with Rick Bratton.
Welcome back, everybody. This Week in America online, thisweekinamerica.us. One review says of the contemporary fiction Rocket Man, it's one of the best books I've read in a long time. Something for everyone. Intrigue, mystery, double cross, false accusations, dishonor, and redemption. On April 9, 1959, NASA introduced America's first astronauts to the press. Scott Carpenter, Gordon Cooper, John Glenn, Virgil Grissom, Walter Schirra, Alan Shepard, and Donald Slayton, seven men, all military test pilots, carefully selected from a final group of 32 candidates. But the real truth of NASA's search for America's best pilots is not found in the 32. They were certainly worthy, our best and brightest, but perhaps the very best never got the chance and served his country in obscurity. A contemporary adventure fiction woven around actual historical events, Rocket Man, from author Earl Perkins. Earl always wanted to be a sports writer and a novelist. At the tender age of 64, he finally got around to penning his first novel, that's Rocket Man. In high school, several teachers and classmates saw his talent and passion for writing, encouraging him to pursue. He planned to put himself through college to learn his craft, but real life got in the way. A family, 45 years as a mechanic, construction contractor, electrician, retiring in 2016, and now a successful author. Rocket Man, called a page-turning tale that's worth reading, from Earl Perkins. And Earl is our guest on This Week in America. Earl, welcome to the program. It's great to have you with us today.
Rick, thank you. It's really great to be with you, and I want to say just thanks for having me on today.
It is our pleasure. And what an excellent book, Rocket Man. Earl Perkins is our guest on the program. And I'm reading at the beginning of the book, you're 8.5 years old. It's May 1961. You're watching Alan Shepard is there cramming him into a Freedom 7 and sort of authored in the space age for the U.S. Is that where this whole fascination with the space program began for you?
It did. It was fascinating for me. I woke up early in the morning to help my dad with something, and they're on the TV. They were putting this guy in a rocket. And I said, "What's going on, Dad?" And he said, "We're about to go in space for the first time." And I could not believe it. And it just grabbed my mind, and I started reading everything at school that I could about the process of how these astronauts were picked. And it's a fascinating thing. Of course, the movies came along like The Right Stuff. It was a big movie in the early 80s,
yes,
and stuff like that. But I followed religiously the space program. It just fascinated me, always did.
And we can follow that fascination in the book Rocket Man. The book is about the Cold War and high-stakes espionage as well. It's interesting, your background with Russians, much like mine. I was first introduced to Russians when I was a child as well, watching championship wrestling, and we just knew they were the bad guys. That's where you got familiar,
right,
with Russia, and you realized, okay, they're the enemy, certainly at times.
Right. That's it. Keep up with world events by watching world championship wrestling. You know, that's the same down there. I guess it was nationwide, but yeah, the Russians were always the bad guys. And in real life, you know, I mean, without leaving the politics out of it, you know, it's fascinated me to find out in researching a little bit for the book that how the two countries approached it. After 1945, we took some of the best German scientists we could and claimed that they wanted a political asylum. Russia took 2,000 of them and gleaned off the top 400, and Stalin just had the rest of them executed. And that's the way they approach things. And it's quite a difference. And so, yeah, I've always grown up with the idea that the Russians were the bad guys. And it's hard when you meet a Russian to think of them as bad. They're really not. I mean, the country, you know, didn't have the best intentions for everybody, but...
Yes, and it's hard sometimes to separate the actual citizen from the people running the government.
It is.
But like so many of
it
us
is.
That grew up with that in the Cold War and the Cuban Missile
exactly.
Crisis and all of that,
right.
It's we sort of, maybe the younger generation sort of forgets exactly who the Russians were. And you talk about that in the book where Stalin decides to go recruit all these German scientists at gunpoint. And as you mentioned, a number of them executed. The book is such an interesting read on so many levels. At the cover of the book, it says, "For all mankind, he fulfilled the last mission of his disgraced father and saved his country and the world from dark forces of evil." give us just a little bit of background. I talked about where this begins back in 1960. A little bit of background on the storyline, some of the main characters in the book Rocket Man.
Well, I wanted to draw a contrast between a fairly recent, created a fairly recent event around the year 2000, 2001, in the past when it first started. And I thought, you know, I need a bad guy, and of course the Russians were it. And the whole Cold War thing seemed to fit the idea that I had, and that was something that was so sinister no one ever would ever think of it. And a lot of this played off of the I've read a lot about the Russians being a paranoid people, and one reason that the plot developed like it did, with hiding something that we never would have expected and hiding it where they hid it. I don't want to tell too much, you know.
Exactly, yes.
I want the reader to find out. But it just it made sense in terms of how the story I wanted to write. And as I developed it, it became more intriguing, this how this had to work. I had to put a little bit of technology in there, which I'm really I'm just an electrician. I'm not a science rocket scientist, so I did have to research some of this, and I didn't want to overburden people with it, with too much technology, because I'm not Tom Clancy either. That guy is something else. But it fit in the characters. I wanted the main character was Pete Allen, the son of the Rocket Man, and Pete enters the book. He's burying his father, and they're both from Oklahoma, and that's, you know, that's where I'm from. And I always want to give an Oklahoma flavor to a lot of the stuff I write. And he's there to bury his father, and he doesn't find out all about his father until the day he buries him. And with him, he has his girlfriend is someone that he met at NASA, and she turns out to actually be, from a lot of people I've talked to, they love her as the best character in the book, because she's strong, she's capable, she's not a Wilton Lily or anything. She's not a little flower girl. She's her own person, and she's capable, and she does the same thing he does. She flew fighter planes, and she's flown in space before in this story. And she's very capable and every bit as qualified as any of the men in the book. And a lot of the young girls that have read the book tell me they think Jesse rocks.
Well, yeah, there's a role model, and set back in that era, that's a little unusual to have a female lead, a character in the book that's that strong. The book is Rocket Man. The author is Earl Perkins. The book's available, of course, wherever you find books, Amazon, the usual places, and you get information and can order by going to Earl's website, which is earlperkinsrocketman.com. You can link on directly to our website, thisweekinamerica.us, and get directly to Earl's website. As I'm reading reviews, one keeps coming up, the words thought-provoking. And I find that interesting because you read some of the scenarios in the book Rocket Man, and you're thinking them through. Could that really happen in real life? Could it happen in real life today? Is that one of the things you wanted to do with the book, besides entertain us, but to get us thinking about things as well?
It was, because we don't know a lot of times, like until way after the fact, that we knew spying happened in our government and in just about every walk of life. It's even happening today in the business world with all the hacking and all that stuff. But as this took place in the story, they're dealing with something that happened years ago, and it was something that's like a time bomb that's set to go off when things are right for them. And it was either going to be used to destroy or to totally blackmail. And the concept of hiding something on an American spacecraft was intriguing to me. And I had to come up with a way it could be done. I had to research a lot of the flights that took place, things that were landed on the moon or other places, and picked the best one out that would fit. And it ended up with the Surveyor 3 in the book.
You know, it's a great story, and as you set out to do this, there have been a lot of books written about the space race, a lot of novels based on that, the race to the moon. You entered an element of espionage, which sort of sets that apart from everything else that's out there, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does, and, you know, it's funny because I was never a too big of a fan of espionage stuff, but adding that flavor to it as I tried to come up with something for a space novel, that's what I really intended, was a space novel. But the more I worked on this, the more I realized this is really an espionage. It's going to have a heavy espionage. That's the central, one of the central issues in the book, and how deep that could go. And so as it's the story develops, we find out that the Rocket Man was actually done in by a group of people involved in an espionage program on behalf of the Russians. And as that developed, he was unjustly fingered as, it was to drive him out of the military and all that. And the only way, 35 years later, that there would ever be any redemption for him was for his son to finish his last mission.
And that story unfolds so nicely in the book Rocket Man. Earl Perkins is the author and our guest. His website is earlperkinsrocketman.com. Let's talk a little bit about another topic that you touch on in the book, and that's the nuclear threat. That's something that, again, many of us have grown up with for another generation. Maybe that's something that, we never think that's going to happen. We grew up when we were fearful this was going to happen. Talk about introducing that storyline into Rocket Man as well.
Well, I wanted this to be something that the world would realize it had to be done. Now, I'm a little bit political, and I always have to stay away from that because, boy, I can really get wound up on that stuff, but. You know, it's funny, the story and the concept, when it came to me, I started writing, and I was determined that it would be called Rocket Man. And then last year, I think our president started calling the North Korean guy
Rocket Man. Yes.
So one question I always have to get out of the way is, no, it's not about the guy from North Korea. It's none of that. It is about a potential nuclear armed conflict. And something there would be no way out of. So the horrors of nuclear war and the nuclear threat, we've got countries that are trying to get the capability, and they're bad guys, they're not good guys. And the only way we can deal with that is either directly, in the real world today, we can only deal with it directly, and I don't want to see anything like that ever happen. But I wanted just a little thriller that could maybe make people realize the Cold War never ended, and the desire for countries to get the upper hand are as misplaced now as they were when they first started, back after the start of the nuclear age.
And that the book makes you think of that. That's one of those areas I talk about in the thought-provoking. There's a great story there. The book is not preaching. It's entertaining, but it gets you thinking sort of a what-if scenario, which is the hallmark of an excellent novel. Rocket Man, Earl Perkins, the author, is our guest on the program. What I enjoyed as well is the characters. The characters were quite believable. Talk about, especially on a debut novel, of having characters that are so believable. We feel like these are real people as we're reading. Talk about developing the characters.
Well, I knew I would have, the lead guy would be Pete, and I knew what his background would be, but I needed a woman equally as strong. And because she was going to be by his side, and the way she got there is kind of intriguing.
Yes.
But she had to be capable in every way. To do the things that he does. So I developed her character by providing a little bit about her background, and she was athletic and tall and all that stuff. And she was from Texas, which is good for a boy from Oklahoma. You know, gives good natural back and forth. But her and then the characters, as I wrote the book, the characters developed around them. And one was the Jim Torrance, who's a strong second male lead in the book. He's a real good upright guy, but he kind of works on in the dark a little bit, because he's got this real high clearance with in fact he's in there looking for bad guys in NASA, and he knows some of the stuff that's going on, and Pete doesn't know that he knows it until he gets with him and figures some of this stuff out. But Jim became a strong second, and then some of the remaining characters, I had to have one bad guy who was a Russian, and he was not Russian by name, he was Russian by heritage. His parents were Russian, but I kind of painted his character with a dark side to him. Very standoffish, not the kind of guy that, and he didn't treat women good, and he was just generally a bad guy. I tried to think of every bad thing I could think of to put him in that light, you know.
Well, he does come across as a bad guy. An excellent job in developing the characters. What are you working on now? Is there a sequel in mind for Rocket Man?
Well, yeah, I have two different paths that I could go. One involves, in the epilogue of the book, there's two places that tip off what could be an epilogue. And I think people will see that. One, it's centered around Jesse. And the other is around one of the black crewmen that backed him up, named Evander James. And I gave just a touch of his character in the book. He's a really capable man, smart, brilliant pilot. And the follow-up to that would be he would be the first African-American to command a moon landing mission. And I've got some other things around that. It'll have some social comment if it works out.
Well, but, looking forward to hopefully a sequel, because this is such an interesting story. I mentioned when you were starting it back in high school, I know the one thing that you really wanted to do was write a romance novel. It doesn't sound like you've got a romance novel coming. Are you working on that now?
Well, to be honest, I have a 300-page novel written that got me in trouble with my wife.
it's too much romance in the romance novel.
Well, it's the first book I actually ever have written, but it's I didn't know how to formulate a story, and so I checked on the internet, you know, for some good ideas, and they said, well, take something that really happened to you and build around it.
Ooh,
of course, that's why it's a novel, because it's not all true.
Yes.
So that's what I did, my wife, who's just sweet as she can be, Kathy read she read a little bit of it. She said, "You know what? You're still in love with her." I said, "No, I am not. I married you." You know, so it was kind of funny, but I do have it. You know, I think my sister has it. I took it off my computer so there wouldn't be any more problems with it.
But, no evidence. Get rid of the evidence.
Yeah. Well, no, she knows about it, and. And I'm also working on a Western. I love Louis L'Amour. I used to grow up reading Louis L'Amour.
Oh, yes.
And that's in a real infant stages. And as a sports enthusiast, I have always wanted to be a sports writer. And I'm currently in about 400 pages into a book about the football program at the University of Oklahoma from the Second World War on.
Ah, that would be fascinating.
It's a big deal. It's a massive book, and I really, my writing sometimes tends to be like my mouth. I talk too much, and so I write too much. So I've got to look at this stuff, and I'm about 400 pages in it, and I've still got a little ways to go. So
Interesting, all of the various genres that you're working on, and we definitely will stay in touch and hopefully be able to talk about some other products. The book, the first novel is Rocket Man, Earl Perkins, website earlperkinsrocketman.com. A minute or so left in the program. I know you've been working with Reader's Magnet to make this dream come true with the published novel Rocket Man. What's that experience been like working with Reader's Magnet?
Well, I tell you what, it can be frustrating at first, but if you trust what they tell you, Reader's Magnet has been great. Elias and Jenna and Sophie, the three people out there that have worked with me, have just been great, and they've kind of held my hand through all this, and it's a good experience because they can't tell you everything they know up front. I mean, you have to learn some of it as you go, and they have done a great job with that. And it's a real good experience. If you let them be your teacher, they can really help you out. Because I've had 60 years of wanting to do things a certain way that I had to kind of change, and they really helped me understand it's a good way. And Reader's Magnet, boy, they have really been good.
Well, it is a good way because the finished product is excellent. You are a very talented writer. How does that sound when someone says, well, that's Earl Perkins. He's a published author now. Are you getting accustomed to hearing that?
Well, no, not really. But I do hear it. And I, you know, my friends and relatives, you know, if I walk in the door, you know, they'll mock me and bow or something. You know, he's a published author. All I can do is laugh at it, but. Hey, anybody out there can do it if they have the dream, you know. And it's a real lifelong thing for me that I always wanted to do, and now I love it, you know. I just want to close by saying I love the feedback that we've gotten from this, and it's exciting. The readers, a lot of the readers tell me it plays out like a movie for them.
Yes,
so I take that as a big compliment, but. The book has a little humor, a little history, a little technology, not too much. It's part love story, part mystery, like you said earlier, part sci-fi, and it's fast-paced and it's got a real good feel-good ending. I wanted people who'd been in the military, or people who've had loved ones in the military, to read a story about someone in service to their country that never lost sight of the fact that they swore to protect and defend the country. And the fact they didn't have a uniform on anymore didn't stop them from fulfilling that. And that's what this story's about. And most of the country didn't forget the sacrifice in the end.
Exactly.
And his honor's restored through his son.
Indeed.
And it's Rocket Man will leave you feeling good about your country and despite all the flaws we may have, especially to those in service to our country and provide the freedom that we have.
It will do that, and it's all in the midst of an excellent story. I mentioned with the intrigue, mystery, double cross, false accusations, dishonor, redemption, and feeling good at the end. The book is Rocket Man by our guest, Earl Perkins. His website is earlperkinsrocketman.com. Book also, of course, available at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, the usual places. And you can link on directly to Earl's website by going to our website, thisweekinamerica.us. Earl, a pleasure having you on the program. Hopefully we'll stay in touch. Anxious to see if there's a sequel and the other books you're working on out there as well. Thank you for being with us on the program.
Rick, thank you so much for the opportunity to be on your show and with you and your listeners. This has been an honor for me.
Well, it's been our pleasure. It's an excellent book, Rocket Man by Earl Perkins. Information at our website, thisweekinamerica.us. We're back on today's program after we take a break for these messages.